is a day of thanksgiving. God's been so good to me. Every day he's blessing me. Every day is a day of thanksgiving. Take the time to glorify the Lord today. Every day is a day of thanksgiving. God's been so good to me.
Jazz Vespers tonight. We clap a little bit, we dance a little bit. Come on, has God been good to you? Every day is a day of Thanksgiving. So glad that you are here at Jazz Vespers, our fall Jazz Vespers service. I'm Luke Powery, the Dean of the Chapel, and let me just note two slight changes in the spirit of jazz. In the first song will be Glory, Glory, Hallelujah. And then the fourth song will be You Can't Beat God's Giving. Those two changes, and anything else is bound to happen, so we will see. But as we start tonight, I invite you to rise if you're able. Stand to your feet. And repeat after me. Give thanks to the Lord. For he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. This side, give thanks to the Lord. For he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. You know I'm coming your way. This side, give thanks to the Lord. For he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Everyone, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Before you take a seat, I invite you to greet one another. Pass the peace, give somebody a handshake, a holy hug, a holy kiss, and welcome them to this service tonight. So glad that you're with us.
Hallelujah, since I laid my
Please join me in the word of prayer. Let us pray. Precious Lord, I ask that you bless this event this evening and that your hand will be with us, keeping us from hurt or harm. Lord, I pray for the spiritual and emotional healing of everyone here tonight, so that your spirit might fill us, inspire us, and create in us a new heart of love and trust in you. Lord, help us to be a living and visible example of your kingdom, so that our spirits may grow, be sharpened, and renewed in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we all say, Amen.
Good evening. My name is Carissa Tu, and I will be reading this evening's Old Testament lesson. The Old Testament lesson comes from Psalm 150, the New King James Version. We are led to holiness this way. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. and worship. Just think about all the good things he's done for you, what he's been to you, what he means to you. Every time he was there when no one else was there, just because of his goodness and who he is.
Good evening. My name is Siandra Ellison, and I'll be reading this evening's New Testament lessons. Tonight's scripture comes from Paul's first letter to Thessalonians. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other, and we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Jesus, 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 Jes if I was at my home church. I might still be there. But I'm going to hasten on. Bear with me. I've been dealing with a bout of laryngitis over the past week, so I don't have my full voice. So I'm going to try not to shout and holler tonight, all right? But if I feel it. This evening's Thanksgiving exhortation comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, that was already read, where Paul simply says, he, in this rapid-fire exhortation, encourages the church at Thessalonica, I've heard different pronunciations, to rejoice always, pray often, and in everything give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In everything, not some things, but in everything that you do, give thanks. So as this scripture sat down in my spirit, I was trying to figure out, what does it really mean to give thanks? How can you give someone or something thanks? Traditionally, we split up the word thanksgiving and work the concept of giving and thanks separately. We teach our children from an early age to always say thank you to someone when they receive something, be it tangible or not. We ourselves were taught as children similarly that it is better to do what? To give than to receive. But very few, if any of us, were taught to actually give thanks. At best, we were taught how to say a little old Thanksgiving prayer. I'm thankful for, and you said this at the meal or somewhere in a Sunday school at church. And we were taught how to tell someone thank you, but we were never taught how to give someone a thank you. So again, I was left puzzled. What does it really mean to give thanks? What was Paul really saying to the church at Thessalonica? In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. One text says, give thanks in all circumstances. Eugene Peterson and the Message translation says, thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you who belong to Jesus Christ to live. Well, I got to be honest, if I look at it in this way, if I put on my sanctified imagination, this poses a theological conundrum for me, if I can be honest. I have to be honest. Can I be honest up in here in Duke Chapel on this evening? I'm not thankful for everything that I endure. Let's be honest. I'm not thankful for every trial or tribulation that I have suffered through. I have had moments in my life when I looked up to God and said, I survived that just to face this. I survived the latest natural disaster just to have to deal with FEMA. You may have survived that one demon in hell just to face another devil in a different shape and form. You might have survived the foreclosure in 2008, but in 2019, you're facing bankruptcy. You survived working on one job, but now you're facing a whole other problem on a different job. And in all of these circumstances, no matter what, I'm supposed to give uncircumstantial thanks. I'm supposed to be thankful for all of this foolishness, all of this mess, all of these trials and tribulations. God ain't about that life. Some may say, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. But maybe, just maybe, that's just a catchphrase we say to gloss over how we really feel. If I could take some time and hang out here homiletically for just a moment, just because we can construct a theological framework that God is good all the time does not mean that God feels good all of the time. Let's be honest, those times when it feels as though you can't get a prayer to go past the ceiling, God does not feel good in that moment. But God is the only thing you have to hold on to before you let your sanity go. That's that theological conundrum. That's that paradox. It's hard to believe that God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Late in the midnight hour, when the sound of the air conditioning or the heating unit has cycled off, and and the refrigerator sits silent, and all you can hear at best is the ticking of a distant clock, and all you can hear are the soft sobs coming from your throat as tears cascade down your face as you lay in bed trying to figure out how and why has such calamity come to your house. Why were you the sister or the brother that had to be the caretaker? Why were you the one to have to be the parent that buried their child? Why didn't the miracle of spontaneous remission happen when it was your parent that was on the deathbed? The catchphrase, "God is good all the time," suddenly feels like a cruel joke. I'm talking about that moment when the only thing you can do is pray about it, because it's the last thing you know how to do before you kick in the towel, flip out, and go to the other side and lose your natural born mind. Whether God is good or not at that exact moment, God doesn't necessarily feel good in the moment. It's that moment you find yourself questioning God. God, why did you let me love them so much just to let this happen to them? And why is this happening to me? You ask God, why did you give me the feelings and emotions just to experience heartache and pain like this? You feel in that moment that no human being in life should ever endure the heart-rending pain that you are experiencing. And it's in those moments when the words of Paul are telling us to give thanks and everything, give thanks. Not just say thank you, but to offer up and give thanks. Well, what do you mean by that, brother preacher? I saw a hand in the back. I'm glad you raised your hand and asked that question. Where are you going with all of this? So it's in the Koine Greek that Paul uses here. The Greek word is eucharisteo, which I probably did not pronounce that right. I'm sure that somebody over in Duke Divinity School who said, I don't believe that young man pronounced that word correctly. I'm going to try that one more time. Eucharisteo, which literally means translated to give thanks. All right, that's what I already said. That's nothing new here. But a breakdown of this Greek word lets us know that the first two letters of the word means good, and charis means grace. So maybe a more literal translation could mean that the word eucharisteo doesn't really mean to give thanks, but it means good grace. So it's at this moment when you read, "In everything give thanks," or "give thanks in all circumstances." Perhaps what Paul is really trying to tell us is that in all circumstances, we should properly acknowledge that God's grace works well. And this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. So now, if giving thanks really means properly acknowledging that God's grace works well, when I look back over my life and I think some things over, I can truly say that there were some moments I need to go back and give some thanks. The psalmist helps me out. Even when my enemies came up against me and circled all about me, I can take this time and give thanks. That's properly acknowledging that God's grace works well, and it was nothing but God's grace that kept me. When my soul looks back and wonders how I got over, I can pause and not just give thanks, but properly acknowledge that God's grace works well, and it was grace that brought me safe thus far, and it is grace that will lead me home. When you think about the goodness of Jesus and all that Jesus has done for us, you can look back at the nights when you spent on the side of your bed praying to God to do something about your situation, and still the next morning when you got out of bed and nothing had changed. But whatever the circumstances were that were designed to take you out and leave you down for the count, I can still take this moment and say, I'm going to properly acknowledge that in the midst of my situation, in the midst of my trials, that God's grace still works well. It was God's grace that did it for me, as the old folks would say. God is a mind regulator, because God's grace will give you the peace that passes all understanding. If I could take a moment and give thanks for what God has done in my own life, and properly acknowledge that God's grace works well, because God is the one who can be our burden bearers and our heavy load sharers. I can take a moment to give thanks in my own life and properly acknowledge that God's grace still works well. That's why Paul could later write about a thorn in his side as a messenger of Satan and hear the Lord's reply that my grace is sufficient for you. God's grace is always sufficient, and it's God's grace, God's amazing grace. That's how sweet the sound through many dangers, toils, and snares. I have already come. It's God's grace that brought me safe thus far, and God's grace that will lead me home. In all circumstances, good or bad, big or small, I dare you to stop where you are and give God some thanks. That's properly acknowledging that God's grace still works well, that God's grace is still sufficient for anything you have to encounter or endure. If I was at my home church, I would put it this way. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, I can't help but to thank him. And when I think about it, when I think about what God has done in my life, you have to stop and give thanks. And when I give thanks unto my God, I'm simply acknowledging that God's grace still works well. Oh my God, accept our thanks and praise, for this is the will of God that is in Christ Jesus. I'm going to go to my seat before I tear this place up. But is there anybody in the building who can stand to your feet and say, God, I thank you. God, I thank you. You didn't have to bring me to the end of 2019, but somehow you found a way. I'm going to give you thanks in the midst of my circumstance, in the midst of my trial. I'm going to say that God's grace, it works well. Put a praise right there.
Oh, yeah. Amazing grace. You know it. How sweet the sound. And praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Sing to the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Oh. Praise Even as we praise God, we know there are many things going on in the world and in our lives, in our families, at our institutions. And so we come to this moment in our service. It's prayer time. We call it jazz prayers. If the ministers can get in their places at the various stations, there are three stations. So to my left will be the prayers of blessing down on the floor. It's in the transept area. Over in the transept on this side will be prayers for healing with oil, anointing oil. And then also closer to the side chapel, you can light a candle as your prayer for someone, for something going on in your life. And so there's stations. So as the music plays, you can go to as many stations as you want. You can go to none. But offer your prayers to God. God knows what we have need of before we even ask. And what we ask is, as you form the lines, to begin the lines, there's side aisles in the chapel, to come this way, down the side aisle, okay? And so it's prayer time, and this is the prayers of the people, literally. Prayers of the people. Your prayers to God. May they be incense to God as we pray to the Lord. Let us pray.
Of the way you care for me. Thank you.
Even as some finish their prayers, we gather all of our prayers together from this community and beyond this community in the one prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Why don't you stand for the benediction? And then there will be what we call the jazz coda, the final song by John and his team. In everything, give thanks. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forever. And all of God's people said, Amen. Can we thank John Brown and the Little Big Band for their leadership tonight? Come on.
Protection every step of the way, and I want to say that.
bless you.
Go in peace. Go in peace. Go in peace. God bless you. They might have something. They'll probably keep playing.